I'm Charlie. Today we are looking at Canadian-born Jerry Cotton, who died suddenly in 2018. Hundreds of millions of dollars in investor funds vanished into thin air. But when law enforcement, the banks, and online detectives tried to track down the cash, it appeared 30-year-old entrepreneur may not have been all that he claimed to be. Jerry owned several properties, including a number of rental properties in Nova Scotia. Amongst other extravagances, he had bought himself a luxury cruising yacht costing him $600,000. There was also his Lexus and private. And as you can imagine, the list goes on. He was a quiet and kept to himself type of person. He preferred to keep most people at bay, meaning that he surrounded himself with acquaintances. He was friendly, but had very few close friends. He was not boastful. He rarely discussed his work. What is known is that he set up his own business in 2013. He was the founder and owner of Quadrica, he being the only one in total control of the cryptocurrency exchange. He ran it from his MacBook Pro, which he was never without. He suffered with Crohn's disease, a type of IBD. For those of you who aren't familiar, it's caused by inflammation of the stomach and can be quite painful. Basically meaning that whilst others around him could eat and drink to their heart's content, he limited himself to certain foods and drink that wouldn't cause him adverse reactions. Having been in a relationship for some years with girlfriend Jennifer Robertson, tied the knot in October of 2018. And then, practically before the ink was even dry, everything appears to have snowballed. Just days into their honeymoon in Jaipur, Jerry was taken ill. He allegedly had a bad reaction to food due to his Crohn's disease. Before doctors could stabilize him, it was said that his heart stopped. Then they were able to revive him, but then his heart stopped again. A mere 24 hours after the beginning of a stomachache, he was pronounced dead. The official cause of death was complications from Crohn's disease, but here's the interesting thing. The gastroenterologist who had originally seen him alive and had treated him stated that on hearing Jerry had been shortly thereafter pronounced deceased, it just didn't sit right with him at all. This doctor was left baffled and uncertain on the diagnosis. He also pointed out dubiously that no autopsy had been requested. Well, great confusion ensued. Jerry's body was returned to the hotel and then sent out again. Embalmer refused to receive it because he was brought in from the hotel. So employees then took the body to a local medical college where a staffer performed. The next day, Jennifer flew back with his body to Canada. News of his death was abrupt and came out of the blue. From the get-go, his sudden death didn't add up. It was questionable why Jennifer was so eager to immediately flog Jerry's private yacht, the one he had blown $600,000. As the weeks went by, bizarre news came to the surface. It was leaked to the press that he had written his will on the 27th of November, 2018, just days before traveling to India. And if that wasn't suspicious enough, it was then discovered that the only person passwords to the accounts holding Quadriga's funds, cryptocurrency, and cash worth approximately $250 million was indeed the now supposedly deceased. Every penny just vanished. Putting it mildly, a lot of people had questions. More like 75,000 Quadriga account holders. The Nova Scotia Supreme Court declared the company bankrupt and selected the accounting firm Ernst & Young to serve as its third-party monitor, responsible for securing the lost funds belonging to Quadriga's creditors, as well as the FBI, the Royal Canadian Mounted Police, further investigated the case. The most effective and thorough to this day have been a number of cyber sleuths who have searched any information they could about Gerald Cotton online, and the general consensus is that he is very much alive. Digging into his background, it was found that he had a relatively average upbringing. He grew up in a large brick house on a quiet suburban street in Belleville, in Ontario. His parents owned an antique store. He had graduated with a bachelor's degree in business administration from an honors program in Toronto. This was back in 2010, and after that, he got into crypto and founded Quadriga just 3 years later. So, what's the theory behind him likely to have simple answer is the collapse of Quadriga. Basically, it's believed that he used the money from new investors to fund the withdrawal of older ones. In short, he unintentionally fell into a Ponzi scheme. He was counting on the growth of Bitcoin. He was sure the price of Bitcoin was going to go up. He risked everything by borrowing money from his customers. Had it worked out, he would have, of course, made millions. But, tragically, as the saying goes, don't put all your eggs in one basket. He couldn't keep up with the fluctuation of Bitcoin rates or the withdrawal requests from customers. It turned out that by 2018, he'd lost a total of 115 million dollars. By taking full advantage of his customers' capital, he bankrupted his own company. He used it for his own gain and for trading, which failed. Resulted in a mammoth loss to the point of no return. There was just no way to turn things around and make the money up again. He knew what was coming, what he would be facing. His company had collapsed. He would be under very serious criminal investigation. He'd be facing jail time. And that image of a young, successful tycoon would be replaced with disrepute, fraudulent, disgraced worldwide, and in all probability bringing great shame and scandal to his family. Even if it wasn't imagine the loss of face, having to face his parents, and the many people who put total trust in him. It doesn't bear thinking about. Is it reasonable to think he was looking? Appears he strategically planned the trip to India, combining it with taking his just married wife on honeymoon there. Conveniently, investigations, getting to the bottom of what actually happened. But in India, where he could get his hands on a fake death certificate. It's also a place commonly known where foreigners aren't accustomed to the cuisine. Not so coincidental then that he picked it as the very place where he had tummy trouble. But what is puzzling is that he went something pretty standard. The first thing he would have been given were PPI meds, which would bring down the inflammation. Doctors would also be checking his vitals, therefore keeping an eye on his body temperature, his pulse rate, his breathing, and his blood pressure. None of this appears to have taken place. He just died. Just like that. Normally, someone in his truly, tragically died. Or, as many are led to believe, he used this sudden